The world's urban population is growing by 200,000 people every day from now until 2050. This is a huge opportunity to build new cities, bigger cities, cities of opportunity and abundance, and cities that heal the earth. But the question is, where will they be built? Welcome to Edenicity, Best Practices for Sustainably Abundant Cities. In my last episode, I kind of trashed the poor design of cities as they stand today. But I want to make clear that cities are good. Want more friends, jobs, and opportunity? A well-built city has them in abundance. That's why so many people are moving there. Cities also have great ecological benefits. Half the world's population lives in cities, and yet cities occupy only 2% of the land area of the planet. Now, that urban population is going to swell to over two-thirds of the global population by 2050, according to a 2018 report by the United Nations. But of the 2.5 billion more people living in cities by 2050, 90% of them will be in Africa and Asia. The thing that must be very exciting for many of these new and growing cities is that they have the potential to leapfrog economically and socially past most of the industrialized world in a single generation, as Singapore did between the mid-1960s and the mid-1980s. How will they do it? Through five key commitments. First, they need to commit to a strong city-by-city identity. Second, high density. Third, high public amenity. Fourth, no bad neighborhoods. This was the key to Singapore's success and also to Vienna's success, that there would be no slums or terrible parts of the city to live in. The only way to do that is by lifting everybody's circumstances up, by making housing a human right for everybody. And then finally, committing to simple ecological design. Now, if you're living in the rest of the world, which 95% of my audience is, you might wonder, well, okay, if 90% of this is happening in Africa and Asia, how does it affect me? Well, that 10% is still pretty huge. We're talking about 20,000 people a day, or 7.3 million people per year, flooding into the cities of the Americas and Europe and Oceania. So this would include Australia and New Zealand. And that is a really significant number of new people. In addition, there's a wild card in the form of the climate migrations now affecting most of the world. And this could cause people from anywhere in the world to move just about anywhere else in the world in the next 30 years. Where will we build these new urban areas? Well, there's five basic options: wilderness, degraded vacant land, mega cities, crumbling cities, and growing cities. Let's start with the most obvious choice that most people think of when we imagine new cities, and this would be wilderness. It's not necessarily just beautiful forests. Wilderness can include swamp, scrub, bush, bog, tundra, offshore areas, and some deserts. Are these good places to develop from a sustainability perspective? Absolutely not. These are the areas that need us to leave them alone so that we don't endanger more species. Given that half of the living biomass of the world has been demolished by human activity, we really need to protect these places. The first rule of Edenicity is do not settle those areas. Of course, what lures people to these places is that they're cheap land, low financial cost. And it's true, what offsets this is that there's very little infrastructure, except when those areas lie near the coast, where they can be reached by sea, or near rail lines or highways. Of course, I think a lot of the people who are attracted to building new cities in wild areas is low public resistance. The idea that there wouldn't be somebody who could come out of the woodwork and maybe sue you has to be very appealing to a lot of the very utopian would-be city builders. So I'm thinking of Tolosa, for example. But even setting aside environmental considerations, the biggest drawback to these places is that they have low social energy. Now, what do I mean by social energy? I mean, you've probably heard of social capital, which is simply the total value of all of your relationships, or the total value of all of the existing relationships in a city or a town or a village or neighborhood or what have you. But social capital is very backward focused and tends to look at the status quo. Social energy has to do with the potential to form social relationships. So the social energy of where you live has less to do with what relationships already exist and a lot more to do with the relationships that could exist given the number of people in the area. and also given their economic well-being. Now, I've visited a number of eco-villages in Tennessee, Indiana, and Ohio, among other places. And what I've seen among the ones that were developed in the wilderness on degraded farmland, far from any nearby towns or cities, is that they have very low social energy. This is a huge problem. This is why so many of them basically fail. They tend to just kind of run out of steam. The relationships just don't sustain them. And what ends up happening, I saw this in multiple eco-villages, is that people start going into town for jobs and to take their kids to school or to soccer, church, or other social events. And more, their energy has to be borrowed from somewhere else. What ends up happening is that a lot of these eco-villages become what I call gravel road suburbs. I've seen it over and over again. It's a thing. So the strategy for the wilderness, for the sake of people and for the sake of the planet, is do not develop these areas, no matter what. Yes, I know they're cheap. Yes, I know there's nobody going to haul you into court, but just don't do it. The next option is degraded land, such as abandoned mines and damaged farmland. As far as sustainability goes, settling them using the Edenicity model is better than nothing, because it would increase the total biomass in these areas. But all the other options on our list are much more sustainable. So our best strategy for degraded land is wild habitat restoration. What about the big cities? I'm talking about New York City, Chicago, Los Angeles, Paris, Singapore, the really big, dense megapolises of the world. Well, surprisingly, from a sustainability standpoint, these are pretty good places. The highest density cities like New York City and Hong Kong and Paris are already multifamily and could easily go car-free. The lower density megacities, such as Houston and Los Angeles, could easily become food and energy secure without going beyond their borders, although transit is a little bit harder sell in those places. Now, our biggest stumbling block in these cities is going to be the very high cost of doing anything. On the other hand, so much of the infrastructure is already there in the form of public transit and multifamily housing. Where there's so many people, it's very easy for even a small fraction of the population to sound like a big, angry mob. So the public resistance to change in these areas is really intense. On the other hand, it's possible to tap into a huge amount of social energy. So for these cities, it's a resounding yes, we should develop Edenicity in megacities. And our best strategy is public advocacy and bold planning. So the really happy situation in these cities is that both the government and public advocates can play a really strong role, and the initiatives can come from either place. What about shrinking cities like Detroit? These are also very sustainable areas for development because there's large areas of already damaged land just waiting to be rehabilitated. And if we bring in a lot of forests and farms and orchards and green roofs, we're increasing the total biomass. And so this is a good thing. There is some legacy infrastructure. Most of it is falling into disrepair. So this can be good as well as bad. There's likely to be good connections to the rest of the world, and that can be used to increase social energy once the city gets going. But for the moment, shrinking cities have kind of low social energy because a lot of people are leaving, and also the people who are there are contending with a lot of trauma in the form of reduced services. So there can be a lot of crime and water and electricity outages. So it can be a really traumatizing, difficult time for some of the residents. And this saps their social energy. This saps their total ability to form really good relationships and put energy into new initiatives. Therefore, the key strategy for turning these places around is a combination of investment and bold government planning. There just isn't enough social energy in these places to move things forward fast enough to make a difference. What about growing cities? These are wonderful places from a sustainability standpoint, and I would argue that these are the best bet to start in the United States. There's lots of poorly used land that can be rehabbed for better uses. In Columbus, for example, we have 1,500 people per square kilometer. By comparison, Edenicity has about 7,000 people per square kilometer. So you could vastly increase the density, make everything much closer and easier to reach, grow all the food you need, provide all the energy you need, and it would still feel less crowded than it does today. So growing cities would be places like Columbus, Pittsburgh, Syracuse, maybe Houston. That's kind of on the cusp between a mega city and a growing city. These places have good infrastructure that could be improved fairly quickly by taking lanes out out of service and putting transit in, and reasonably large land banks that could be repurposed for garden and forest areas, as well as for infill housing development at higher densities. They have pretty good social energy, but I would not rely on citizens' initiatives to really move things in a sustainable direction. Why is that? The current residents have been there a while and are going to be resistant to change. Change is scary. The new residents are not going to feel very empowered, so it's really going to fall to government to initiate bold moves. Again, if I had to place my bet on just one of these five options, it would be growing cities. But any of the currently occupied cities are good candidates for sustainable urban growth. The two things that are not good candidates, wilderness and large areas of vacant land. These are areas that need to be either left alone or restored to wild habitat so that we can increase the total living biomass of the planet. Next time I'll talk about the minimum and maximum sizes for sustainable developments such as hedonicity. You won't want to miss that one, because this is when we start to get into whether or not you're going to see it where you live, or whether you might have to move to live somewhere truly sustainable. Be sure you're subscribed so you don't miss it. Take care, stay green, see you next time.